thank you, Femi. That's about the nicest thing you could have said to me. I've just read a dissertation by one of our MA students where she interviewed other MA students, and what they say about what our MA does to them made me cry, because they talk about changing their sense of themselves, their relationships with other people, understanding their mothers differently, reordering their relationships, refusing to tolerate sexism anymore. And actually, we don't teach them that, but we do give them access to radical feminist ideas. And that's where it takes a lot of women, if it's offered to them in a way that they can engage with it themselves. So thank you. I don't really know where this is going to go today, because I've actually never spoken about this before. So I haven't got text. I've got some PowerPoints that are my thoughts. And some of it's about thinking back to my very early beginnings as a feminist, when, as a young woman this morning said, I didn't really have a voice at all. But I worked with the children in the refuge that opened in Norwich. And Women's Aid enabled me to find my voice. And it's enabled some of our most wonderful feminists, including Denise Marshall, who we talked about this morning, but also many others. Many of us found our voices, found our politics, through working in this organisation. So although I'm going to say some things that are complicated and critical, I want to acknowledge that Women's Aid also grows feminists, as well as saving and changing the lives of the women and children that they work with. So what I want to do is think with you about the her story of refugees. I don't want to say they were fantastic and wonderful in the 1970s and it's all terrible now. That's not the story I want to tell. I want to talk about how refugees were located, and violence against women actually, in relation to the Women's Liberation Movement, about the politics of feminism in refugees, and what was it like, what is it like to work or live in a refuge. That's what I'm going to try and do. So, before I do that, I haven't actually read this book, but I like the way that she says that there are stories that we tell about feminism. And we need to think about what story it is we're telling. Are we telling a really simple story about progress? Are we telling a story of loss of our feminism? And I do sometimes think, as radical feminists, that's one of the stories that we tell. Are we talking about the story of resurgence, waves, generations? I don't like any of those ways of talking about feminism. I tend to talk about it as a tapestry that we all are part of making, and sometimes we need to unpick bits of it because we got stuff wrong and we need to start again. But the stories I want to tell are not simplistically any of those. I think the stories I want to tell are stories of complications, of where we move forward and then we get stuck and then we have to think our way around something, where we're actually contending with the political context that we are living with in the particular space on the planet that we live at that point in time. Those things affect how and why and which way we do feminism. So, violence against women has been central, I would say, to radical feminism. That's not the same as saying it was central to the Women's Liberation Movement. That story is much more complicated than many of you younger women here could ever imagine. There's at least three of us in this room who were part of trying to get one of the demands of the Women's Liberation Movement in the UK to be about violence. It was actually the very last one that was adopted because there was so much resistance to it from other feminists. Not liberal feminists only, but socialists, Marxists. It was seen as a marginal issue.
And anti-men.
Yes. And anti-men, yes. So So some of us, from the very beginning, were trying to talk about this issue as crimes of dominion, crimes of power. And I think we have established that in certain framings of violence against women, but it wasn't easy and it wasn't straightforward. And in doing this, we had to then create things that didn't exist. There were no refuges, there were no helplines, there were no self-help groups. We made all of those things as responses that we as women wanted ourselves and wanted to provide for others. And we did it in the spirit of the 1970s. That was a spirit of anti-hierarchy, of collectivism, of trying to not recreate power relations in these new kinds of provision that we were making. We didn't know how to do that, I have to say. Some of us made big mistakes, but some of the ways in which we tried to work and tried to explore hierarchy and relationships of power, I think were fundamental challenges to things that are embedded in patriarchal relations. And I would say that's one of the things that we've lost. And we did this within a collective we. We thought of all women as probably having had at least some experience of what Betsy Stankel called intimate intrusions. It wasn't that there was a group of experts who were going to support women and then a group of victims over here. This was the reality for all of us. The threat of violence was a reality for all of us, and the actuality of violence was a reality for all too many of us. But I really do want to get you to understand that this really was a contested space within the women's liberation movement. And there were many women who thought that actually even creating refuges was a wrong thing to do. And some radical feminists thought this too, because it was kind of supporting women so that they could go back into heterosexual relationships again. The very early history of refugees is extremely interesting. You may have heard of this woman called Erin Pitsey, who did indeed open the first refuge. It was a women's centre in Chiswick. She then wanted to be in charge of the emerging movement of other women creating refuges. And she hated feminists, but in particular, she really hated lesbians. She wrote a letter to every single local authority telling them that they should be careful of these women's organisations that wanted to open refuges, and that they should consult with her, because she would tell them which ones were not these terrible, radical, man-hating lesbians. And I tell this story, I still don't know how she knew this, but anyway, she invited all of the group that I was with at the conference to her house, to garden party in the Saturday evening, and she didn't invite me. Now, I wasn't a lesbian at the time, so she actually saw something in me that I didn't see in myself till much later. But this history is a history of contestation within the women's movement, where we're trying to work out what our politics are, and we're trying to work out, are we going to be liberal or are we going to be more radical? And I think some of those argumentations and contestations actually went on within Women's Aid, and one of them was around sexuality. The very early refugees, the standard of housing was extremely poor. We were overcrowded. Those women must have been absolutely desperate to stay there, because what we were able to offer was really, really limited. And at least three refuges began by squats. And the one in Birmingham, They actually sent a call out to all the other women's aid groups to ask whether we had any women who didn't have children living in our refuges who would be prepared to go and squat a refuge so that they could actually have a refuge in Birmingham. And one woman actually went from the refuge I was involved in to that squat. So in that sense, there was an activism to actually even create the houses, and some of the women who came to the refuges were part of that activism. We thought of ourselves as collectives. We told ourselves that the women and children who lived in the refuges were part of the collectives. I would now think about that as a kind of false equality, because they didn't have access to the same information as we did. And we didn't have the time or the resources to do kind of feminist education classes in the refuge that we would have needed to do in order for them to participate as equals with us in meetings. Karen reminded me this morning about minibuses and how every refuge had a minibus. Or if we didn't have one, we knew who we could borrow one from. And that we would all go up and down the country to women's aid conferences, that you come to the car park and it would be full of minibuses. And we will come with the women and children from the refuge. And I think the biggest test for me of whether something we were wanting to move towards as a policy or voting or whatever, if I could explain it on the way there to the women from the refuge who were in the minibus, then that was great. If I couldn't explain it to them, then there must be something wrong with that direction. And then on the way back, it will be conversations about the debates, about fallouts, about racism, about sexuality. So actually we were doing feminist education in the minibus. And again, I think that would not happen anymore. Women from refuges are not at women's aid conferences anymore. Lots of workers are not there anymore either. One of the other things that used to happen at women's aid conferences was that there'd be a social in the evening, and one of the women's bands, Jam Today, or women's theatre groups, my favourite of which was called Cunning Stunts, would perform. And again, it gave access to the women who lived in the refuges to women's culture, to lesbian culture, in a way that certainly we couldn't do in Norwich, a little small town. We couldn't give access to that kind of thing. So you could do that through how we organised around then. This is, if any of you want to read about the very early history, this is a piece in Trouble and Strife number 4. It's an interview with Jana Hamner and Joe Sutton, who was the first national worker. And this here is the letter that Erin Pitsey sent, because she contests that she ever did this. So we actually decided we would print it so that it was there for posterity to show that she did say those things. I was in this group in Norwich. It was the second refuge outside London to open. And we were a microcosm of all of these things that were going on in a wider sense. We were a collective of white women, most of whom had young children. And there were big class issues in our group, but we didn't talk about them. It was incredibly empowering and challenging, this idea that we should, as a group of women, know how to do everything that was required to run this house and to run this organisation. So we had to learn basic plumbing, we had to learn how to do accounting. It was huge, in the sense that many of us had never done any of those things. But learning to do them then meant that we then wanted to enable the women in the house to do them too. And the fact that they saw us doing them, and the children saw us doing them, and that we then would employ female plumbers, female electricians, it was actually a way of challenging that notion that, it was putting into practice the notion that women can do anything and everything. We used to have house meetings every week with the women and children's meetings with the children. And those issues that came up there would then get fed into what we call the support group, which also met every week. But the most important thing for me about the early years was what I've called kitchen table talk. We didn't have an office. We didn't have workers. We'd have volunteers. And you'd come in and you'd sit around the table and you'd just talk with whoever was there. You'd fill in forms. You'd sort out whatever needed sorting out. And there's one particular conversation I remember when I came in and I found a postcard about rape and marriage and I put it up on the notice board. And the most incredible conversation happened then with seven women starting to talk about their experiences of sexual violence within. So it was that we created a space where things happened in a kind of organic way. And I think there's less and less of that kind of space for those kinds of conversations to happen. And we were creating women-only spaces. And it was important to us that they were women-only, and it was actually important to the women who lived there and the children that they were women-only too. Which led to a lot of contention about whether men should ever have any engagement with refugees. In quite a lot of refugees, they did some work with children, usually taking them out, not in the refuge, but actually spending time with them outside, sometimes play schemes during the summer. That was the case in Norwich. And we fought with each other for 2 years over this issue. But in the end, we decided that actually, no, they shouldn't, that we should really be a women-only space inside and outside the actual building. Lots and lots of really difficult issues about racism and about what I've called lesbophobia, but anti-lesbianism. Ongoing conversations within groups, with some of the women in the refuge, and in our region, in East Anglia. Huge debates and conversations and sometimes actually quite horrible and difficult conversations that were hurtful. This was not an easy space to be in at that time. East Anglia region, half of the groups originated in the Women's Liberation Movement, but half of them originated in the Labour Party. So this idea that all women's aid groups were radical activists, no, not all of them were. And two of those Labour Party groups left the national organisation because it was too radical, which actually meant there were too many lesbians there and too many radical feminists. But at the same time, there were also two of those groups that were truly, truly radical in the 1970s. One of them challenged us all and worked with us to understand the situation of traveller women and insisted that we couldn't have what many groups wanted to have, which was to say, if you've got more than four children, we can't accommodate you. And many traveller women have very large numbers of children. But also, one of these groups developed a disappearance route. So if we had a woman who kept being found, they would absolutely make her disappear, create a new identity, and none of us would know who she was or where she was. And I think that's an incredibly radical thing to do, because it's about breaking the law in order to create safety for some woman who's got a crazy man who is not going to let her go. We used to take lots of risks. We used to not report women to child protection. In fact, we'd do anything other than report a woman to child protection. Karen also reminded me of how we would go and get all of women's belongings back from their houses, sometimes with an escort of police, sometimes not. Quite a lot of this, including me, actually confronted violent men who were actually standing outside the refuge. I actually confronted one who had a shotgun, which was very scary. But you wouldn't do that now, because it would be health and safety and risk assessment. But actually, our sense was, this is what you needed to do. And it was also there was a power in doing it as well. I actually was shaking inside, but there was also something about the fact that I had a voice that came out that was authoritative and said, you're not going to kill me. If you kill me, you're going to go down for a really, really long time, because I'm not your wife, so fuck off. And he did. And I wouldn't want to do it again. But there's something powerful about claiming that kind of space, and I'm not sure that we're enabling younger women to do that in the same way. I don't think we always put the women and children's interests first. I think sometimes you can use something like a refuge as a vehicle for a wider politics, and one of the things I want to say is that's not what refuges are for. Activist campaigning groups are for that. Radical feminist groups are for that. Refuges are actually for creating safety and sanctuary for women and children and enabling them to rebuild their lives, and not necessarily a vehicle through which to do our ideological politics. Really difficult issues that I sort of am glad we're not in anymore. We used to have this thing called an open door policy. So any woman calling, you had to take her in. So I would sometimes come in on a morning if I was in to volunteer, and there were three families in the sitting room who'd come the night before. And we said to the women who lived there they could take women in. They didn't need us to. But you then had this impossible situation of a small space, overcrowded, children who didn't have any space to be, women who were thinking, well, how is this any better than where I came from? I don't think that was a good thing, and I don't think it was a positive thing, although it was a principle that we shouldn't turn any woman away. And we're now in a situation where, I don't know, is it like one in two women who try to get in a refuge can't get in? So, in the 1980s, we decided we were going to take on the state. And this is a debate in Women's Aid, but they were funding the national organisation and they wanted to come to the conference. And the predominant view was, I was a minority. In saying I didn't agree, but anyway, that they should tell them no, they couldn't come to the conference. I argued that if they take the money away, we've got no way to organise as a national organisation. I'm in this region where the feminist hold is really tenuous. If I don't have the national organisation, some of these groups are just going to kind of drift off into liberal... we voted to tell the Home Office that no, they couldn't come to the conference, and we lost funding for 4 years as the national organisation, and I think it did huge damage to Women's Aid as an organisation, and huge damage to how then it reconstituted itself in terms of feminist politics. We also had tensions about what was our relationship to the women in the house. Were we sisters? Sisters in struggle, as the question was put to me before the conference. Were we supporters? Were we friends? And I think we were unclear about that. And that created, I think, some difficulties and tensions within particular refuges, because you then end up having favourites. You spend more time with the women who are more interested in some of the feminist ideas, or who it's easier to get on with, or who've got a great sense of humour, or, you know. And then from there, there were far too many examples of women who were in support groups having relationships with women whilst they were in the refuge. We fall in love with who we fall in love with, but actually it's not okay to have a relationship while you're in a position of power in relation to them. Actually, you need to just say, we need to wait until we're in a different situation. And then we had this whole sense of that the women in the refuge, when they left, should be able to become part of the organisation. And many, many, many of them did. But I think we said that that was enough, that somehow just their experience was enough. And I certainly was in the group at times when women joined a support group and they were incredibly judgmental of other women because they hadn't done it the way that they'd done it. That somehow the way that they'd done it was the right way to do it. And we didn't do training in those days. We didn't have training to be a volunteer or to be a worker. And sometimes I think we put too much store by experiential knowledge as opposed to learning certain kinds of skills and ways of engaging. This is one of my favourite posters. And Sandra McNeill was actually at the meeting in Norwich Women's Centre when we created this poster. It was a campaign that involved a lot of women's aid groups, but not only, Red Crisis Group as well. And we did it on Mother's Day in 1980-something. And we all had these posters, and we went and put them up on church notice boards before. So there were kinds of activism that were happening that are actually radical feminist activism is why it's there. I'm not going to talk very much, but this is a woman called Molly Washington who creates these models of a social movement model of a refuge and then a social service model of a refuge. And she's basing this on interviews with the East Anglian groups. But interestingly, the group that I was part of wasn't interviewed, I don't know why. But anyway, she said, this is how we tend to think about refugees, and we tend to think there was a social movement model, and now most of this social service model. And what she wants to say is, actually, it's more complicated than that. The social movement model still exists, but very few refugees can actually work within it. And the social service model exists, but actually quite a lot are in this intermediate zone where they're having to adapt to some of the things that have changed about funding and also some of the ways that we learned that actually some of our practices weren't best practice, but hold on to some of the principles and the ways of thinking that were there in the social movement model. And one of the things that changed in Women's Aid that I think is not a bad thing was actually about acknowledging that the work that you do supporting women in a refuge is skilled work and that we should be recognised as women and that we should be financially compensated for that kind of work. And there's certainly a whole history in Germany, for example, where they insisted that work in refuges was paid from the very beginning because it was a principle about women's labour and that we value women's labour. We get the emergence of the specialist BME women's organisations towards the end of the 70s and into the 80s. We start this idea that there should be purpose-built accommodation, not adapted houses that are meant for one or two families where you've got seven families living in them, but actually properties that recognise that there will be seven families living in here, and so how many bathrooms do you need? Can there be small kitchenettes that are within little flats almost? And again, I welcome that. I think women and children escaping violence deserve to live somewhere that is easy for them to live in and that gives them some kind of autonomous space for themselves when they just want to spend time with themselves. There's an idea that there was a therapeutic shift, and that you can see that really strongly in the US, that it becomes all about counselling, and counselling about how did you get into the relationship, and so you can prevent yourself having another relationship like that. So implicit victim blaming, really. That's not as evident here in the UK, but there's some element of it. Lots of groups got charitable status. That brings with it a whole set of responsibilities that you have to fulfil. And also, I do think that there is, if we're going to take public money, we can't insist other organisations are accountable when they take public money and not be accountable ourselves. One big story about women's aid that I'm not going to say too much about, but it wasn't just about the work with women and children in the refuge. It was the social change work we did externally with other agencies. And I think it's really easy to underestimate how much of the change in statutory agency responses is down to the work of women's aid and women in those organisations. It was us who did this. It would not have happened without the constant engagement and badgering of women all over the country. And part of that was also creating entitlements, creating rights, rights to housing, rights to protection orders, right to certain kinds of settlements on divorce. And austerity is actually eroding every single one of those rights. Women today have less rights than they had 5 years ago. And I fear that it will get worse. And some of the things that have happened, I think, have pulled women's aid groups into ways of thinking, ways of working, that are actually unhelpful. We all have to shape-shift in terms of funding regimes, in terms of the politics of the time. I know that. But there are some very, very hierarchical structures now in certain refuge organisations, and some other more unconventional structures, but I'd be hard-pressed to tell you that I could think of one which is still a collective. And that's a kind of trade-off about, do you value autonomy more against recognition and influence? And I think Women's Aid went for recognition and influence. There are new ways of engaging survivors in organisations, but as I said, they're very rarely, if ever, at the conference anymore. Almost all are immersed in this discourse about risk that is not from a feminist perspective, and the risk is focused on the woman. She's not a risk. Well, a few of them might be. But mostly, she's not the risk. The perpetrator's the risk, but the perpetrators remain invisible. And one of the things that I thought we had done was to insist that the surveillance and everything should be on the perpetrator, not on the woman. And we're now in situations where I think women are subjected to huge surveillance through MARACs, through child protection processes, and the sense that actually they are under pressure from someone else, and it's the someone else who should be having sanctions against them, is somehow lost. Those of you who work in public services will know about commissioning and the way in which it has pitted groups against one another, and that some of the larger groups have absorbed some of the smaller groups, and who has lost out most in this process has been the small community-based black and minority ethnic women's organisations.
Did you know that Women's Aid in Rotherham have taken over the BME? They said we can do it cheaper. And that's a Women's Aid, not Stalin, not housing.
I know, and that's not the only story like that, Sandra. I'm really, yes, I know.
And transgender services in London.
Sorry?
Transgender and refugees.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, males and women's refugees.
Let's hold it and talk about it in a minute. I want to talk about that, yeah?
Can I just know what MARA seats are?
Okay, it's a multi-agency risk assessment conference.
And BME?
Black and minority ethnic, okay. And they are now required in every area. You're not required to have a women's refuge, but you are required to have a MARAC. And you get referred into MARAC if you are a high-risk case. And all the agencies are obliged to attend and share all the information that they have on that family, which means that woman. And she is not there. So they talk about her, they talk about her risk, and she's not there. It's as unempowering a process as you could possibly imagine. But many women's aid groups are now deeply embedded in this, and there's only a few of us on the outside actually saying, hold on, wait a minute, what about women's privacy rights? What about, have you all asked her consent to share this information? We don't think so. And thirdly, why isn't she there to actually speak for herself? And the focus is totally on her and not on the perpetrator. And the original idea was that it should be the perpetrators who were being risk assessed, but it's actually now women who are being risk assessed.
So what risk is she being assessed for?
Further violence. So but also that she might continue to live in a situation where her children are at risk of witnessing violence.
So it's kind of mental.
It's what?
I'm sorry, it's mental. It's kind of
yes, it is. But it's the fundamental building blocks of what the government sees as its response to domestic violence.
Isn't that England? I just want to say that England, there are slight differences in Wales about MARACs. I just want to say that.
But there's also, they also have MARACs in Scotland too.
Yeah, they do, right? Wales, and I know, I sit on MARACs, but if you're there, it can be slightly different. Yeah.
Okay. I know loads of feminists who want to say that to me, and I know that you make a difference in the room, I know that, but I have a fundamental problem with the entire system of it. And in all of this, I think there's been a muting of radical feminism in how women's aid groups and women's aid nationally talks about what it's doing. It positions itself as a service provider. I went onto the website and I wanted to see whether there was anything, whether the F word was there, but also whether there was anything about changing women's position in society more broadly, and there isn't. There is something about ending men's violence, but the organisation actually positions itself as a service provider, which maybe it should do, I don't know. Having said that, they're still saving and transforming lives, and I want to give you some quotes from women about what engaging with a women's aid group has meant for them, because it's very easy to be abstract and critical at an ideological level, but actually there are still women for whom an engagement with a women's aid group and the support that they get enables them to reclaim the freedom that violence takes away from them. And the previous one, you'll see expanded space for action. I don't use the word agency. I talk about space for action, because actually there's a context in which you do or you don't have more or less freedom. And talking about agency, there's no context for agency. So space for action for me is putting that context back. These photographs are photographs women took themselves to represent. This is a project where we talked to the 100 women over 3 years, and they took photographs to represent what that 3 years had meant for them. This woman, this was the first pair of boots that she actually bought for herself, where she chose what she wanted to wear rather than thinking about what he would want her to wear. There is some work, mainly from the US, on what makes a difference for women. I'm not going to talk too much about this, but what I do think is fascinating about it is that what it finds is that those things that we thought we were beginning with, validation, respect, treating women with dignity, that's actually what women say matters to them in terms of specialised services. So what we thought we were creating is exactly what they experience and value. And these are some words from women talking about the terrible experiences they have in statutory services. And if there's one reason to continue doing and providing women's services, even if they're not in the way that we imagined that they might be in the 1970s, it's that it takes women out of these services where they are disrespected, hurt, harmed even more, harmed again, and made to feel like they're, as Ava Lundgren said, a nothing, a nothing. They're not worth someone's basic respect. This is my friend Sarah Scott talking about how that we've got a triple track of feminist engagement. We do have activism, campaigning. Then we've got our creation of our alternative institutions. And then quite a lot of us, at certain points, go into the inside of mainstream services. And sometimes these things are in tension, but she argues we get the most change when we can align them together and take advantage of political moments. So this is my last slide, and that's my question. Have we lost the move? I've put CEO in inverted commas, but the woman who is the CEO of Leeway, Norwich Women's Refuge, is actually a woman who was in the refuge when I was a volunteer there. And I don't think that would happen now. And I want us to ask why. And I want us to think about what's the difference, or what's the relationship between this idea about boundaries and sisterhood. Can we have a sisterly relationship with women when we're in a support relationship with them? Is that possible? Are women who've used services encouraged to come back? And loads of them want to give something back. And we don't create any spaces where they can do that. And I don't think many services, some Red Crises do, and a few women's aid groups do, but they don't take that notion that Linda Herman had, that activism is part of rebuilding self and undoing some of the harms of violence, to actually be active against it, grow something inside that is really significant and important. And my last question is about how we position ourselves in relation to that concept of survivor, because I think that's part of how we've lost the we, that actually we're positioning women who've had experiences of violence over here, and us, the supporters, the researchers, the whoever, over there. And if we do that, then there is no we. So I suppose I want us to get back to the we. Thank you.